Welcome, everybody. We have a quorum, so let's get started. I'd like to turn it over to Steve to see if he has any announcements. So go ahead, Steve.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Steve Tupper, Cape Cod Commission staff. I'll start off with a few announcements before we get started with the meeting. So first, the meeting will be held virtual with all members of the Cape Cod Metropolitan Planning Organization participating remotely, pursuant to Chapter 20 of the Acts of 2021, an act relative to extending certain COVID-19 measures adopted during the state of emergency and signed into law June 16th, 2021. If anyone is having any technical issues, use either the chat box on your screen or call 508-362-3828 and staff will assist you. Participants wishing to speak, please use the raised hand function, which can be found by clicking on reaction or participants icon, depending on the version of Zoom. Telephone participants should press *9, again, *9 to indicate they wish to speak, and *6 to unmute themselves. All participants will be muted until called on by the chair. And this meeting is being recorded. To ask if you could please raise your hand if anyone else is also recording the meeting today. Don't see any others recording the meeting. Meeting materials, including the meeting recording when available, can be accessed at capecodcommission.org/MPO. Because members will be participating remotely today, we will be taking a roll call on each action we take today. We ask members to please state their name when making a motion. I've got a couple additional announcements before we move on to the roll call vote. A couple new staff roles here, so I just wanted to share with the group. So first, bidding a fond farewell to Mallory. She's moved on from the commission. So we have actually filled her position already, joined today by Phil Mealy, who will be helping with the taking of minutes, and you'll be hearing from him in terms of getting ready for the quorum. He's only been into the job a week, so we're going to give him today off and just let him observe, but you'll be hearing from him going forward. Also a couple of new staff roles as well. I'm now serving in the position of deputy director, although still focused on transportation and still be running the MPO meetings. Colleen Medeiros is now transportation program manager. So you may be hearing from her, and I actually have over the last month in the absence of Mallory, and she'll be running the JTC meetings. So by and large, you'll see many of the same team, a few new additions. Certainly look forward to a good 2021 with the MPO. And that's it, Mr. Chair.
All right, Steve, you want to go ahead and read the roll, please?
See, I'm not as good as Mallory. I didn't unmute right away there. But
well,
here we go.
We'll forgive you this one time, Steve, okay?
Okay, Stephen Wolfel.
Here, representing Secretary and CEO of MassDOT, Jamie Tesler.
Kamala Hasner.
Here, representing Administrator Jonathan Gulliver, and congratulations to you and Colleen, and welcome aboard, Phil, and wish Mallory the best.
Thank you, Pam. Harold Mitchell.
Harold Mitchell, representing Cape Cod Commission.
Robert Lawton.
Present, representing the CCRTA.
Mark Forrest.
I am present and representing the Barnstable County Commissioners.
Latoya Green. Robert Steen.
Present, representing Town of Barnstable.
Judith Froman. Cheryl McMahon. We'll circle back to a couple of these. Kevin Galligan.
Kevin Galligan here, representing Subregion C. That includes Brewster, Chatham, Harwich, and Orleans.
Robert Weinstein. Okay, I'm going to circle back because I see some names here. Judith Froman, are you with us this afternoon? Or what about Cheryl McMahon? I do see them on the list, David. I don't know if you could see if you can work out any issues they may be having. I see you, Judith. It looks like you're present.
Hello, present. Subregion A.
Thank you. And Cheryl McMahon. I may have heard present there, but we'll keep working on that. While we do that, I'm going to announce a couple of other ex officio positions. Is there anyone here today representing the Cape Cod Joint Transportation Committee?
Rich Waldo here, present, Vice Chair JTC.
Thank you. Anyone representing the Park Service or National Parks? U.S. Army Corps of Engineers. Steamship Authority. Federal Highway Administration. Federal Transit Administration. Okay, very good. We do have a quorum, Mr. Chair.
All right, why don't we get started? Hold on 1 second. Let's see. The next item on the agenda is the approval of the prior meeting minutes, which are from November 15, 2021. Could I get a motion and a second to approve them, please? And please identify yourself.
Harold Mitchell, motion to accept the minutes as written.
And Kevin Galligan, second.
All right, any changes or comments on the minutes? Someone has their hand raised. I'm not sure who that is.
So whoever's got a phone number, last four, 9128. If you'd like to speak, please unmute yourself.
Hi, this is Cheryl McMahon. I'm sorry. When they were calling the roll call, I accidentally hit the wrong button and disconnected myself. So I don't have a camera on my PC, so I have to connect by phone.
Well, thank you for joining us. I'll include you in the roll call now. We're voting on approval of the minutes from November 15th, 2021.
All right. Okay. Anyone have any changes? All right. Seeing none, you want to read the roll, Steve?
Steve Wolfel?
Yes.
Pam Hasner?
I abstain. I was not present.
Harold Mitchell?
Yes.
Robert Lawton?
Yes.
Mark Forrest?
Abstain.
Robert Steen?
Abstain.
Judith Froman?
Yes.
Cheryl McMahon?
Yes.
And Kevin Galligan?
Yes.
The motion passes.
All right. We are now on to the next item agenda, public comment. Are there any members of the public would like to address the MPO today? And please remember, you want to make a comment, please raise, press not star 9 on your phone or raise your hand in the Zoom function. I don't see anyone, Steve, do you?
I do not, Mr. Chair.
All right.
Hey, excuse me, this is Darrell Crossman. I don't have that raised hand feature on my screen.
Okay, go ahead.
Okay, hey, sorry, I just dropped all my stuff. My name is Darrell Crossman. I live at 15 Telegraph Hill Road, Sandwich, Massachusetts. I'm also a member of the Sandwich Bike and Pedestrian Committee, but I'm not representing them at this time. I'm representing myself as a private citizen. The concern that I have is twofold. One is that we have the Bike and Pathways project that has been approved by MassDOT, 75% completion, and we were also presented with that. I don't believe that there was, given adequate public input. I don't remember specifically having a meeting that allowed the public to have input on this design. My concern is that there are not enough safe crossways being proposed in this project. As I don't know, many know that there are developments that are off of Service Road that have only the one way in, one way out. And on the individual streets, a lot of them have not been given what I believe is fair oversight in allowing those having safe crosswalks, not necessarily lighted ones, but ones that would be allowed from each street that comes off of Service Road. Some of the ones that are proposed, I do have a concern with, and the one specifically is the one at the Spalding Rehab. They give us back the feedback that, they got to have safe sight lines and all that there. Just recently, I think within the last few weeks, there was a bad accident at the top of that hill. That is at the top of a hill. You cannot see coming up from, I'm going to use old exits 2 and 3 because I'm still not familiar with the numbers. But you know, coming from 2 to 3, you cannot see until you get to the top of the hill. I mean, a lot of times that's why there's been accidents there. Yeah, that's where they want to put a crosswalk. Not really sure why that is when, you know, they tell us that, you know, they could put sidewalks on the other side of the road. There is a sidewalk that goes from the rehab hospital all the way to exit 3. And then they're having a crosswalk down at Madison, which is not that far down the road. So, I mean, I guess I'm concerned with, you do public input, you talk about your concerns, and yet it seems like most of the time when the, I'm sorry, that's my private phone, when the, you know, when you do go public input, it's always usually MassDOT just comes back and says, you know what, we're not doing it for these reasons here. And I feel that some of those reasons aren't necessarily adequate. And like I said, the public along Service Road from 3 to 2 to 4, I don't believe was given adequate chance to have input into this design. So I just wanted to air my concerns both on the, and honestly, I mean, in all the years, I've lived here for over 30 years, and all the projects that I've done with MassDOT, gone to the meetings and given input, it's always, we can't do this because of this. It's not necessarily, oh, I'll look into it and do a fair assessment of what our concerns are and taking a look at. And the more specific one was when they did the redesign of exit 2, they didn't want to do a turn off lane coming down Route 130 onto Service Road. It had to take a lot of pushback from the selectmen and our state representatives to have them even take a look at it and finally say, oh yeah, that's what we should do. And it's a great thing that they finally did it, but it, you know, shouldn't take that kind of effort for MassDOT to look in what people's concerns are. So that's what I wanted to bring. So I, you know, if you have any questions, you can let me know, and I can give you more detail on, you know, the concerns. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Daryl. Are there others who would like to speak to the MPO today? Steve, do you see anyone else?
I see no hands, Mr. Chair.
All right. Why don't we move to agenda item number 5, which is the election of vice chair. I guess I'm going to turn it over to you, Steve.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. So the position of vice chair must be voted on annually by the MPO. The main functions of the vice chair are to chair the meeting in the absence of the chair. We've had that a couple of times over the last couple of years, so it's good to have a vice chair for that reason. Beyond that, there's not many specific powers or duties, but we certainly appreciate Woody Mitchell taking that on the last couple of years, and he has chaired a couple of meetings as we have gone forward. So today we'd be looking for a nomination, potentially a selection of a vice chair. Certainly anyone who has a general familiarity with the MPO would be qualified for this position. Certainly encourage members to discuss anyone who's interested in the position or make a recommendation of another member who may be interested in serving this position. Should the members come to a consensus, we would be able to have the members appoint the vice chair in this meeting today.
All right. Would anyone like to nominate someone as vice chair?
Mr. Chair, this is Kevin. Could I, through you, make a query to Woody Mitchell?
Sure.
Would you wish to be nominated, Woody?
I am going to be stepping down as chairman of the Cape Cod Commission in June, if everything is... you know, we never quite know. So I would be willing to continue on in the role, but if in June I am replaced, you would have to at that time replace the role.
Well, right. If I could continue, Mr. Chair, if other members are comfortable, I will run the risk of waiting until June to see what happens, but I am happy to nominate Woody Mitchell for continuation in the role of vice chair.
All right. Is there a second, understanding that we might have to address this in June? Is there
Perlman second.
All right. Anyone want to comment on this? All right. So, Steve, why don't you read the role, please?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. So just to, so we'll be clear, the motion and the second is to appoint Harold Mitchell as Vice Chair of the Cape Cod Commission for 2022 and go through the roll. Steve Wolfel.
Yes.
Pam Hasner.
Yes.
Harold Mitchell.
I'll abstain.
Very onerous of you. Robert Lawton.
Yes.
Mark Forrest.
Yes.
Rob Steen.
Yes.
Judith Roman.
Yes.
Cheryl McMahon.
Yes.
Kevin Galligan.
Yes.
The vote passes.
All right. I don't know if I should congratulate you, Woody, or not, but you're in for the ride at least for the next tip cycle. How's that?
thank you.
All right. We're on to agenda item six, which is the 2022 safety performance measure targets. And I'll invite Dave from the Cape Cod Commission to go ahead and present. Go ahead, Dave.
Thank you, Steve. Good afternoon, everyone. Dave Nolan from the Cape Cod Commission. And I'm going to do a brief presentation here to describe the MassDOT safety performance targets for calendar year 2022. I'll go through some slides here. And at the end of this presentation, we would be looking for a vote to adopt the MassDOT safety targets. Could we go to the next slide, please? So this is something we do every year. It's one of our requirements from Federal Highway that MPOs establish performance measures every year. In previous years, the Cape Cod MPO, along with other MPOs in Massachusetts, have chosen to adopt the statewide safety targets brought forward and tracked by MassDOT. This is usually done because DOT has all the statewide data and has a significant influence on spending, especially in regards to safety projects. So like I said, today I'll go through a couple slides to show these safety targets and the MPO can discuss and potentially vote on the safety measures. So the first slide here shows the total fatalities across Massachusetts. What each of these bars represents is a five-year rolling average. In general, we've seen a downward trend over the previous years. The targets coming forward would continue that downward trend. It's important to note that no fatality is okay, and the goal is ultimately to head to Vision Zero, where we have a road network that we have no fatalities on. Voting for these is important for federal funding, of course, so keeping this downward trend is something that we're looking forward to do over the coming years. Next slide, please. Like I said I'd be a little quick with this presentation. We do have quite the agenda today. I believe all of these graphics and the information on the side here is in the meeting packet as well. So you can take a further look at this afterwards if you so choose. This one here is the total serious injuries, again, showing the five-year rolling average. A steeper decrease in injury-related crashes across the state over the most recent years we have, and again, continuing that trend forward. Next slide, please. And the last safety target here is the total combined non-motorized injuries and fatalities. This one has sort of fluctuated over time. In the most recent couple of years, we have seen a slight decrease, which is good. And again, showing our calendar year 22 safety target at the end there, 471 crashes. And that's the last MassDOT performance measure there. Could we go to the next slide, please? For reference, we wanted to show some of the Cape Cod trends, show kind of how our region is faring in recent years. This is the total fatalities across Cape Cod through that five-year period of 2016 through 2020. Again, seeing a slight downward trend. Next slide, please. Serious injuries, again, a moderate downward trend here as well. That red line there, the red dots there show the rates, the injury rates. These are the serious injury crashes. And next slide, please. And keeping with the trend of the MassDOT information showing the combined non-motorized injuries and fatalities across Cape Cod. This one seems to fluctuate a bit more from year to year as the number of crashes are lower. It seems to fluctuate a little bit more than some of the others. Last slide, please. This is just sort of, you know, a high level overview of everything I kind of just went through. Showing the MassDOT safety performance targets that are under consideration, So we'll be looking for a potential roll call vote for these targets. We presented this, I believe, a week and a half ago to the Cape Cod JTC, and they recommended that this be moved forward for consideration by the MPO.
All right. Can I get a so does someone want to make a motion of what the safety performance measure target should be for calendar year 2022? And then if I can get a motion a second, we'll open up to any questions anyone has of David, Derek, whoever. So is there a motion anyone would like to make?
Mr. Chairman, Harold Mitchell, I make a motion to adopt the statewide Massachusetts Department of Transportation safety performance targets for calendar year 2022.
Is there a second to that?
Perlman, second.
All right. Anyone have any questions for David or Derek or anyone else?
I do.
Who is that?
Rob Steen, Town of Barnesville. Hey, just quick question to make sure I understand what we're actually voting on here. So what we are voting on is the last point on those previous slides. Are we voting on it as a statewide? Are we voting on it as a Cape Cod? Which one of those numbers are we voting on?
David?
David, you're muted.
Thank you, Woody. Sorry about that. Yes, we're going to be voting on the targets moving forward. So that last point there, in the coming year, what we're going to be looking at is the new data going forward to continue those downward trends in all categories.
Right. So is that, but you gave data for both the statewide and for Cape Cod. Are we voting for both those sets of data or strictly for the statewide, and the Cape Cod data was just for our information?
If I might clarify, Mr. Chair, certainly.
Yeah, go ahead, Steve.
So the vote is to support the statewide targets. So the numbers we're specifically voting on are the statewide numbers. As you indicated or as you questioned, yes, the Cape Cod numbers were just for reference because we know that there's often questions about if the trends are similar in our region. We would be voting on the statewide numbers.
Thanks, Steve.
All right. Anyone else have any questions? I don't see any. So, Steve, why don't you read the roll, please?
Thank you very much. Steve Wolfel?
Yes.
Pam Hasner?
Yes.
Harold Mitchell?
Yes.
Robert Lawton?
Yes.
Mark Forrest?
Yes.
Rob Steen?
Yes.
Judith Froman?
Yes.
Cheryl McMahon?
Yes.
Kevin Galligan?
Yes.
The motion passes.
All right. Thank you, Dave. We will now move on to agenda item 7, which is the federal fiscal year 2022 to 2026 TIP amendment number 1. Colleen, please take it away.
Good afternoon, everyone. Colleen Medeiros with the Cape Cod Commission staff. Right now, this agenda item is looking to do our first amendment to last year's TIP for federal fiscal years 2022 to 2026. Next slide. This amendment would allocate approximately $531,222 to federal fiscal year 2022 for the purchase of the Cape Cod Regional Transit Authority to purchase additional vehicles for their dial-a-ride service. So this is adding those funds to allow them to purchase those vehicles for federal fiscal year 2022. And I open it up to any questions regarding this. This is would have to get a potential roll call. And then it would go through a public, a 30-day public comment period, and then we would endorse it at the next meeting.
All right. Does CCRTA want to say anything before I call for a motion a second?
Hi. Yes. Thank you. Well, good afternoon. I'm Leah LaCrosse from the CCRTA. Just want to add to what Colleen said. These funds would be used to purchase electric vehicles to replace our replace approximately 7 vehicles that have reached their end of useful life, and we would like to use those funds to start moving into purchasing electric vehicles for which we already have the infrastructure for, These are smaller vehicles that would be used for our demand response program, our dial-a-ride and our smart dart services.
All right, thank you. I saw someone else seemed like they wanted to speak. Who was that?
That was me, Harold Mitchell.
Just go ahead.
Wondering how many vehicles would be in this purchase, please?
We don't have exact costs at this moment, but we did approximation of 7 vehicles.
Okay, thank you.
All right, would someone like to make a motion second to put out TIP amendment number 1 for public comment, and then I'll open up for any other additional questions.
So Robert Lawton, I'd like to make the motion to proceed with amendment number 1 to the TIP.
Is there a second?
Harold Mitchell, I'll second.
All right, any further questions for either Colleen or CCRTA? All right, seeing none, Steve, do you want to read the roll?
Well, we have a couple of questions.
Oh, like I can't see everyone when they put their hands up, so I don't know. Maybe I've got my things up. All right, who has the hand raised to ask questions? Sorry about that.
Looks like Cheryl has her hand first and then Kevin Galligan.
All right, go ahead, Cheryl.
Hi, thank you. These vehicles, and I'm sorry I didn't have the slide up. I keep dropping it for some reason, but is this to replace current vehicles or is this in addition to existing fleet vehicles?
Cheryl, this is to replace current vehicles, vehicles that have reached the end of their useful life. And instead of replacing them with the normal replacements we would like to replace them with electric vehicles so that we can move towards our goal of being net zero in 2030.
That's a super goal. I appreciate that. In terms of, is there any value in the trade-in value? Do you trade them in or is there any opportunity for auctioning these? Because I found that municipalities, including where I sit on the Dennis Water District, that we are getting better prices when they're auctioned. So I'm curious to see how the RTA disposes of their replacement vehicles.
That's a great question. The CCRTA does a surplus vehicle auction in both the spring and the fall, and any of our vehicles that have come to the end of their useful life are included in that auction.
Okay, and how would someone that was on the MPO know how much was received and where do those funds go? Back to your general fund?
They go back to our general operating fund. It's reported at I'm the director of planning and grants, and it is reported out in my area of the advisory board committee.
So it goes back in the general fund. Is it reallocated for regular expense or just does it have to be spent back on capital?
General operating expenses.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
All right, Kevin and then Rob.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'm so pleased to see this move to EVs. The electric vehicles are really going to help set a great example. My question for you is only because I have recently become more aware of the details of both the eligible uses for ARPA funds as well as the bipartisan federal infrastructure dollars. Is the RTA able to apply for any of those federal grants? And would this be of help in terms of having start to put your toe in the water on EVs to bring more in through federal dollars?
That's actually another great question. And to answer that, we've just been made aware that there are grant opportunities, federal grant opportunities for just this purpose. And we are exploring those opportunities enthusiastically.
Thank you.
So Kevin, just a quick update. You know, we have our annual MARPA meeting where we provide the financials. And obviously with the new infrastructure bill, a lot of us are still waiting for guidance from Federal Highway and Federal FTA. So all the MPOs are going to hear where Federal Highway, FTA are at this moment. They still probably don't have a lot of details, I think. But obviously as it rolls out, we'll be sharing that with all the MPOs and RTAs to let them know what the requirements of those grant programs are going to be and when and all that stuff. Is it, you know, this is going to take a little while to roll out. So
absolutely. Thank you.
Yep. Rob, go ahead.
Yeah. So just a quick question on the operating side of this. Is the expectation that your charging stations will only need to be at your home base and that your charges will be enough to be able to get you through your entire routes and back to home base? Or are there going to be subsequent charging stations needed elsewhere in the communities to support these vehicles?
We are actually, thank you for that question. We are actually exploring all of that now. And we're expanding it. We're exploring that with others. And because we see this as a Capewide initiative, obviously, that's why we wanted to start off small with our fleet. And we figured that this is a great way to do that. We already have the charging stations here to support the vehicles that we want to, that the dial-a-ride, the demand response vehicles need. We already have that infrastructure. So we're starting with this one. As of this point, we don't foresee the need for anything beyond for these specific vehicles that we're looking at right now, the need to go to have any additional charging stations, although there are charging stations throughout the Cape. It's when we move to the bigger vehicles that is going to be a major issue that we're exploring right now.
Just to kind of finish that thought, we're starting to dip our toe in that as well on the big truck side, Barnstable is. Starting to look at EV on large trucks and talking to Volvo and Mack and others on that. So running into similar types of questions. So as you go forward and learn, would be real interested in hearing what you're learning, et cetera, so we could sort of coalesce knowledge and all this.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Anyone have any more questions? All right. Yes. I don't see anyone. Okay.
I don't see any, Mr. Chair. I would want ask if maybe the amendment could be, the motion could be modified slightly just to vote to release draft one for public comment. I think it was.
I did. Robert Law. Yeah, and I'll happy to make that amendment or to make that as part of the main motion, as long as the second agrees.
I'll agree.
Perfect. All right, okay. With that change, can we do the roll, please?
Thank you. Steve Wolfel?
Yes.
Pam Hasner?
Yes.
Harold Mitchell?
Yes.
Robert Lawton?
Yes.
Mark Forrest?
Yes.
Robert Steen?
Yes.
Judith Froman?
Yes.
Cheryl McMahon?
Yes.
Kevin Galligan?
Yes.
The motion passes.
All right. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Colleen. But don't go anywhere because we're on to number agenda item 8, Federal Fiscal Year 2023 to 2027 TIP Development. And I'll turn it back over to you, Colleen.
Yep. So these are, I have a good amount of slides, but I'm going to go through them pretty quickly. So this is our first meeting to kick off the federal fiscal years 2023 to 2027 transportation improvement program development. So we're going to go through the program, the list of projects that are included in the last year's TIP, as well as some projects that are eligible to be added into this year's new slate of TIP funding. So just a quick refresher, the Transportation Improvement Program is our five-year schedule of regional construction projects. It includes not only roadway and multimodal projects, but the transit as well as the Cape Cod Regional Transit Authority projects. We have a certain amount of money each year that we have to financially figure out how to spend, and which leads to a critical decision-making process. So there are several buckets that encompass the TIP. We have our set of regionally prioritized projects. These ones are often led by our municipalities themselves designing these projects and bringing them forth. We also have a bucket of statewide prioritized projects. These are led by some of the towns, and they're identified by the state as priority projects to receive funding through the state prioritization bucket. And then the state also has some in-house projects that they're leading efforts on. So they're also included in the statewide prioritized list. And then we also have our transit bucket as well for funding projects. And that all encompasses the Cape Cod Regional TIP and goes along with all the other 13 regions into the statewide TIP. So here's our development schedule for this season. We're kicking it off this month going over overviews. And then next month, we'll start really digging in. We'll have updated cost figures next month, and we can start looking at discussing the projects, with selection happening in March. And then on our back end, we'll work on a draft document for presentation to this body, and we'll look to release a draft to the public in April, and with a potential endorsement in May after the public comment period. Quick refresher, how to get a project on the tip. It has to be submitted through MassDOT with a project need initiation form, and then it's reviewed by a project review committee at MassDOT for approval. And then the MPO selects the list of eligible projects to program into the tip. And then the MPO doesn't just select any projects, they have to review several factors. We encourage looking at the project readiness. These projects need to be moving along in their design progress to be able to receive the funding in their federal fiscal year. We're looking at the cost. We do a project evaluation score, which we'll be detailing more next month on all the eligible projects. We also look at greenhouse gas impacts, Title VI, and community support. Last year, the Joint Transportation Committee came up with a set of readiness guidelines that's been helping them review as well, because they're looking at this at the same time as well. We talked to them earlier this month, presented these same slides. So this is just a guidelines that we're looking at where these projects should be at in a design level in comparison to their year of funding. So we wanna make sure we're bringing forth projects that are supported and that are moving and don't have many major issues. Moving into our currently programmed projects that were included in last year's TIP. Here's our little handy chart. So right now, 2022 was programmed last year. So we will not be discussing these projects anymore. We're now looking for starting at 2023. And these were the set of projects that were included last year. You can see the red and blue are the regionally prioritized projects. They receive our limited amounts of around 11 or so million dollars each year. And then these orange projects down below are the state prioritized projects. So those are funded outside of the Cape Cod regional target funds we receive, but they are projects that will occur down here in Cape Cod. So this is a quick list here of our projects, regionally prioritized projects, and I'll go into them a little bit quicker in detail. The first one in 2023 is Barnstable Bierce's Way Shared Use Path. This project is moving towards 100% design. So the town has been working on comment resolutions with the 75% submittal, but it seems to be on track and they're for an advertisement of next year. And they're considering adding enterprise crossing. So that's the latest change in the last year or so. Moving in, we also have Wellfleet Route 6 at Main Street. It's a signalized intersection improvement project in 2023. This is regionally prioritized. And it will also include multimodal improvements and safety, as this is a high crash location. Currently, the 75% design was just submitted and a public hearing was held in September of last year. And they're working towards the 100% design submission. And this project is also appears to be on target as well. Moving into 2024, we have a Harwich and Dennis Route 28 reconstruction project. With the graphic on this slide, it's the blue section. The one furthest to the right or on the east is Harwich. I'm sorry, that's the section I'm talking about right now. The furthest east, the red section, that goes over the town line. The blue section is one that was just completed this past summer, a project you may be familiar with. And then the one to the west, near the Bass River Bridge, to the left of your page, is another project that is TIP eligible. But currently, right now, we're talking about the one that goes into Harwich. And this is a project around $8 million. It's regionally prioritized, being led by the two towns, includes a traffic signal upgrade, as well as multimodal improvements, similar to the one that was just constructed in Dennis downtown. The project is moving towards 75% design, which will be due in this year in 2022. They will also need to be conducting their 25% design hearing later this year as well. But as of right now, this project is on target. Now we're into federal fiscal year 2025. We have Bourne Rail Trail, which is phase one, it's just programmed. It's being led by the town, but is receiving statewide prioritized funds. And this is a proposed shared use path from Cape Cod Canal Path heading southerly for about half a mile into the Gray Gables neighborhood in Bourne. So this project is moving towards 75% design submission this later this year. The design public hearing was held last fall, and not too many project changes at this point of time. So this one's on target. Moving on, we have a project in Provincetown on Shankpainer Road. This project is funded through two federal fiscal years, 24 and 25, just due to the limited amount of funding we receive in 1 year. So it has to be spread over 2 years. We call it advanced constructed. So this project also includes a section of Route 6 that's under town ownership to do more of a road diet and convert one barrel of the highway to a bicycle boulevard, construct a roundabout, and then incorporate complete streets improvements on Shankpainer Road. This project is moving towards 75% design this year. There will be a design public hearing in the next few months or so to hear feedback on the preliminary 25% design. And this one is moving on target as well. Also in 2025, we have a project that was added last year. It's a sidewalk project, Route 28 in Harwich to Sakwatucket Harbor. It's about a $1 million sidewalk project. It's being led by the town, receiving regional prioritized funds, and will include a sidewalk on the southerly side of Route 28. This one is at pre-25% design, but 25% design is due actually next month. So this one's moving well right now, and is being coordinated with the town and DOT as well. So there might be a design public hearing later this year as well for more feedback. Also in 2025, we have the Cape Cod Rail Trail extension from Yarmouth heading westerly into Barnstable. This is a project led by both towns and is being funded with statewide funds, about $9.5 million. And the project extends from the Homer Park in Yarmouth westerly to Mary Dunn Road in Hyannis and include a bridge crossing on Willow Street for the new bike path. This project, the 75% design was just submitted in the fall. So they're moving toward 100% design this year. So it's definitely on target. And there may be maybe even the potential to expedite this one as well if new funding becomes available with any of these new federal legislation and grant opportunities. And now we're in 2026. We have an intersection improvement project in Chatham, Route 28 Crow Road, Depot Road and Queen Anne Road. That's led by the town, receiving regional prioritized funds, around $3 million. And the town is working towards a 25% design submission. We have a designer on board. So they're working on that at this point, and it's on target for the outer years of the TIP for funding. And this is the last project in the regional target funds in 2026. We have Mashpee Route 151 improvements, phase two. If you recall, last year we included a Mashpee Route 151 project, but it was phase one. Because that project is a large corridor project, it was split into two phases and due to the cost constraints. This is the phase two, which will start at Old Barnstable Road traffic signal near the high school in Mashpee, heading westerly to Falmouth. This project is a large project, so it has to be funded over two TIP years. So right now, only approximately $8 million is funded in 2026, and we need to seek to fund the remaining $7 million in a future year. But it's a corridor improvement project, includes multimodal accommodations, improving safety as well. This project, because it was designed as one project, both phase one and phase two, is actually ahead of schedule. 100% design submission is due in a couple months. So it's well ahead as well and can be moved up if needed as well, because it was designed in process with the phase one. And here's just a reminder of the state prioritized projects. These are all being led by MassDOT. So we have a couple paving projects. We have one in Wellfleet that will coincide with the intersection project in federal fiscal year 23. We also have Bourne Scenic Highway, Yarmouth Route 28 North Main Street signal improvement, Harwich Elementary Safe Routes to School, a Barnstable Route 6 Mid Cape Highway resurfacing project. I already talked about Bourne Rail Trail and the Cape Cod extension. And then 2026 Provincetown Truro, there's a Route 6 resurfacing project that is being prioritized as well. All right, so now this is the list of projects that are eligible to be added to the TIP but are not currently included. So this is something where we can see what might be able to be programmed this year. This is the eligible list currently right now, and I'll go a little bit more into detail of these. Most of these you've seen all of last year. There's only one that's new today, but these were all presented at last year at some point. So this one is another Dennis Route 28 project. This is called phase two. It's that westerly segment starting at the Bass River Bridge, going to Old Main Street on Route 28. It's approximately a little over $6 million. And it will be including multimodal plans improvements as well. And right now it's at a pre-25% design. And just one thing to note, the Joint Transportation Committee last year noted that this was a priority to fund in future years because it's been in the works for a long time in the town of Dennis, and they've spent a lot of money already on the design. So this was a priority noted by JTC for funding. Next, we have Bourne Rail Trail Phase 4 and the Falmouth Shining Sea Extension Project. This is a collaborative project between the two towns to extend the Shining Sea bikeway north into Bourne, into the Katamit Village. It's about a little bit over a mile section for a shared use path adjacent to the railroad. And the both towns are having this project in preliminary design right now, but it has received a lot of positive support. Wrong way. Sorry about that. The next one is also a Bourne Rail Trail project. It's phase two. This is eligible to be added to the TIP. It's the section that picks up from where phase one will leave off, and it's a middle section. And it's a little bit, it's around $9 million, a proposed cost estimate. And knowing it's a little bit of a longer segment, the town has decided to not prioritize this project. In comparison to, they want to complete phase one and the phase four in collaboration with the town of Falmouth. So this one is currently not the priority, but they are looking at it and have a designer on board with some concepts as well. And again, strong support for the whole Bourne Rail Trail project. We have a project in Falmouth, Route 28 corridor improvements. Right now it's around $10 million. So it's a big project to improve several intersections that are high crash, as well as a bicycle and pedestrian high crash cluster on Route 28 Falmouth, being led by the town. They have a designer on board. They're at pre-25% design, so preliminary, and they've been gaining some public feedback as part of the project. And they just had some feedback in the fall of this last year. So they're moving forward with that as well. This project, Yarmouth Route 28, resurfacing and related work. This was a previously programmed TIP project. It wasn't included last year. This last year is when it fell off, but the 2 years ago, it was included as a statewide prioritized project by MassDOT. Unfortunately, the cost estimate just rose too high. So right now it's currently not funded with TIP funds. It is a resurfacing project on Route 28. That will incorporate multimodal improvements So that's where I think where the costs started to increase. They're proposing sidewalks, shared use path as well. So this project is at 25% design. It just needs more funding. And it may need to be phased because it is a large corridor project. Another intersection project in Falmouth, Route 28A at Route 151. This was previously under design by MassDOT for a high crash intersection. It's at 25% design, but it was dropped from the tip several years ago because the town was not supportive at that time for a proposed roundabout, but it's still an eligible project. And then the next slate of a couple slides, we have some rotary improvements. Right now we have one, this was Mashpee Rotary. This was from a corridor study the Cape Cod Commission performed several years ago to do what we call a rotary retrofit at the Mashpee Rotary to add striping and signage to improve safety as well as incorporate multimodal improvements with the shared use path in orange you see around the rotary. This one, MassDOT is currently developing concepts in-house and will bring a designer on board. It is eligible to be added to the TIP, approximately $6 million. And we saw strong feedback from the public during our project. Sorry about that. And then next one is the Barnesville Airport Rotary Project. Similarly, MassDOT is looking at this intersection with a design consultant to look at to improve safety and multimodal improvements at this intersection, as well as the Route 28 legs leading into and out, leading into the rotary on both sides. This is a follow-up from the Hyannis Access study that Cape Cod Commission performed several years ago as well. And it's got at least about a $12 million price tag currently. And then Bourne Rotary, there's a smaller project that MassDOT is looking to bring forward. They're doing design in-house, and it's about a $3.7 million project, really just to prove some safety at the rotary interimly as well. And this is our last project of the day. So this is a new project that was just recently approved by the MassDOT Project Review Committee in the fall. It's a proposed shared use path on Route 6 from Route 6 from the Main Street signalized intersection project, that's a TIP project, head northerly into Truro to Shore Road. So MassDOT's looking to build a shared use path alongside Route 6 in this area. It's just starting design and concepts, and it does have a price tag, a large price tag. But this one is now a new project that is eligible. So that is my end of my presentation. I'm happy to answer any questions at this time. Next month, we'll have updated cost figures. So some of these might be older, and as well as we'll have some more readiness updates. So really, if these projects are ready to be in their funding year. So we'll have a little bit more feedback from MassDOT that we can present in February. So we'll look forward to those discussions, but happy to answer any questions.
All right, thanks, Colleen. Any questions for Colleen? Pam?
It's just a couple of comments, actually. The Yarmouth, North Main Street, Old Main 28 intersection, that's been officially rolled into the Bass River Bridge project, 28 over the Bass River Bridge. So that could be removed from the list. That will be advertised as one project. And I'm not sure if the slide probably did note this, but I might have missed it. The Mashpee Rotary project, we're also proposing a shared use path to Quinnequisset. And that's been, we've had quite a few inquiries from the community. Specifically the biking community for that. So that's included as part of the project as well.
All right. Others have any questions or comments? All right. I don't see anyone. Steve, do you see anyone or Colleen?
No, Mr. Chair.
All right. Thank you, Colleen. We'll look forward to seeing you again next month for more updates on the TIP and TIP development. So with that, we will move on to agenda item 9 and bring back Dave up to talk about the federal fiscal year 2023 UPWP development. Dave?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Okay, just getting screen control here. So I'm gonna walk us through the Unified Planning Work Program development for the upcoming federal fiscal year 2023. There we go. So just a little background on the UPWP. It is developed annually by Commission Transportation staff on behalf of the Cape Cod MPO in accordance with our federal planning regulations. The UPWP describes all the significant transportation planning activities planned across Cape Cod over a 12-month period, regardless of the lead organization or funding source. The UPWP is developed under the framework of the Cape Cod Regional Transportation Plan, and it essentially follows the same timeline here this spring as the TIP development will. So very similar to the schedule Colleen shared for the TIP, we're starting our kickoff discussions with MPO and internally in the month of January. We'd like to start discussing projects and select projects by the MPO meeting in March, releasing a draft of the UPWP document in April, and then having a final version of the UPWP document released in May. I'll quickly walk through the details of the UPWP document. So the first category of tasks is our management and support of the planning process and certification activities. These projects include working on the UPWP and the TIP, as well as any MPO activities that we work on, having these meetings, preparing, et cetera. Any environmental justice and Title VI work, working on our public participation program, and any regional transportation plan work we do. Our task two projects include our data collection and analysis activities. This includes our traffic counting program, keeping track of performance standards, any database management we do, including uploading information from our traffic counts or crash related information we get in regards to performance standards, pavement management, data collection, any healthy transportation projects we do. That usually includes a lot of our complete street work, helping towns receive funding for complete streets projects or helping them with the development of prioritization plans, and any of our GIS work that our GIS department does for our transportation related projects are categorized here. Our task three projects are our short and long range transportation planning projects. These are the projects where we have a little bit more leeway to come up with some unique projects each year. We always have a corridor planning study that we do. This year, our corridor study is the East Hyannis Route 28 corridor study, which is going from the intersection of East Main Street in Yarmouth to the intersection of Yarmouth Road in Barnstable. So we'll be looking for another corridor study in this upcoming UPWP cycle. Transportation safety projects. This is usually our roadway safety audits we do. We typically do about three of those a year, and any other transportation safety related projects that need to be addressed are outlined here. We typically have a bike planning study as well. We've done bike plans for local communities. This year we're doing a wayfinding signage analysis as our bike planning study. So any ideas for potential bike planning projects would be encouraged. And then we always have a climate change resiliency for transportation infrastructure project. In previous years, we've done an inventory of EV charging stations across our region, where we identified some recommendations for future charging infrastructure across the region. So again, any ideas or projects for that are always welcomed. Task four is our technical assistance activities, is where we do a lot of our transit planning, or transit data analysis, any other technical requests that we get from the RTA. And then task five is our planning and regulatory activities that we do at the commission level. So kind of like I mentioned earlier, our next steps is beginning discussion of projects. If anyone has any ideas or questions now, I'd be happy to take questions. But moving forward, we'd like to select our projects in March with a draft UPWP posted in April and a final in May, with work set to begin in October.
All right, with that, anyone have any questions for David? Kevin, go ahead.
Yeah, just a quick one, Mr. Chair. David, thanks so much for the overview. I really do enjoy the planning work that's done and the support that comes from the commission. One thing I think would really be helpful, and I know as the chair mentioned even previously when I was talking about the federal ARPA and infrastructure funds, I do hope you do your best to document the various buckets of funding so that, number one, everyone's aware, we don't duplicate efforts, that we're, you know, in tune to the windows of opportunity. I'll leave it at that. Thank you.
All right. Thanks, Kevin. Anyone else? All right. I don't see anyone else. All right. I think with that, thank you, David, for that. And we'll be talking more about that next month. So let's move to agenda item 10, which are reports. The first report is from MassDOT. So Pam, I believe it's Barbara, correct? So Barbara, you want to go ahead?
Hi, everybody. Good afternoon. Colleen actually did a wonderful job giving my updates for the day. So I will move on to an announcement that I have for Shared Streets. We have the fourth round of Shared Streets open right now. Applications are being accepted until March 1st, where municipalities and public transit are eligible to apply for those. There's five emphasis for the applications this round. There's two new ones. The two new ones are speed management, which the grants are up to $200,000 with the emphasis is on management of vehicular speeds through design interventions. The other new emphasis is equipment only, which is up to $50,000. And that is for equipment needs of the municipalities. And these are not do not count against the funding given prior for grant funding. And these, I think, are municipalities are eligible to receive two of these grants along with a regular application grant. So this category is a little different. We don't score those. And all the information for that is on our website also. But there's also the bike pad infrastructure, transit supportive infrastructure, and the main streets, which are the same emphasis that we had prior. And again, all that information is available on the MassDOT Shared Streets and Spaces page on the MassDOT website. That's about it. Thank you, Colleen.
All right.
Pam, did you have anything you wanted to go through?
I just wanted to add one item. I did have the opportunity to confirm on the sandwich shared use path plans during the meeting after the public comment period. And we do have five crossings on the shared use path on across Service Road. And including at the Spalding Hospital rehab driveway. And the crossings do include rapid flashing beacons with the crosswalks. So if a pedestrian, a bicyclist does stop and wants to cross, they can cross, press the beacon and the lights will go on. So, we do take all comments very seriously and do investigate inquiries and comments. It's a pretty thoughtful process. So I just wanted to also stress that. But this is a project that it's a town initiative, and we've been working very closely with the community on this. So I just wanted to give a little more information on that.
All right, thank you, Barbara, and Judith, go ahead.
Thank you. Would it be helpful if I got back to the Sandwich resident since he's in our area? I can give him that information if he wants more airtime, then we can address that. But would that be helpful for a quick response at least?
Sure. No, that would be fine.
Okay, thanks.
All right. Next, so thank you, Barb and Pam. The next report is from OTP MassDOT, but Derek had to jump off. Schuster, I think you're on. Was there any updates you had? I believe I saw Schuster.
Was here, now gone, Mr. Chair.
All right, so I guess we have no updates because no one told me anything, so I'm just kidding. But as you kind of alluded to, we are having our big meeting this Friday with all the MPOs, so that's probably the most significant update. The only other thing I would say, obviously Barbara touched on the grant opportunities coming up through the Shared Streets program. Innovation Conference, we're starting planning that already. It's planned to be a hybrid at the DCU Center. So I've only had one meeting on it, so I'm not gonna go too much detail. So that's our quick OTP update. So the next update is from CCRTA. Is Chris on the phone or to give a quick update? All right, go ahead, Chris.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. So a few other quick updates. Leah spoke to nicely our electric vehicle planning and initiatives there. We're in the process of developing our 10-year strategic plan, which involved some of our other larger vehicles and that require different types of electrical vehicle infrastructure. So a lot of logistics and other planning that need to go into that, but we're in the process of developing that document that'll help us get to that stage. We are now we've grown back our ridership to 90% on a weekly basis. That's where we're at this past week. And as part of our customer experience enhancement initiative, we're continuing to make progress in developing our website. We are about 2.5 weeks away from our new website launch. I spoke to this in the last meeting, but overall, there's easier to navigate, simpler to use. Launching a new interactive route map, new trip planner, new live bus tracking that integrates with our interactive route maps. We're looking to add a page to the site that will include bike maps and information. We are also adding another separate section on how to ride. We've developed an inventory of videos that will help riders, new riders and current riders, on how to navigate our system. So again, all part of a larger initiative to enhance our customer experience. Other than that, that's all I have, and I'm happy to answer questions if anyone has them. Thank you.
Hey, Chris, does it make sense for you guys to come and present on the new website and give all the board members a chance to take a look at the right time? So maybe if you agree, maybe you and Steve can figure out the right month to do that.
We would love to. We should be ready to present at the next meeting, but would be happy to.
All right. I see you're shaking your head, Steve. So you agree that's a good idea. So why don't we put that on the next agenda if that all works out? Any other questions for Chris? All right. Thank you, Chris. Next update is from Mr. Tupper on the Cape Cod Commission. So go ahead, Steve.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Just a couple updates. First is on design public hearing that Pam had mentioned about the Bass River Bridge project earlier that is now combined with the Route 28 North Main Street intersection project. So the design public hearing was held virtually a couple weeks ago now, but a recording is available. So you can take a look at that design public hearing and comments are due by January 27th. We do make the effort to post every one of these design public hearings on the commission's website. So you can go either to the link there for MassDOT, or if you go to capecodcommission.org/tip, TIP, we keep an updated list of all of the design public hearings in this region, because we, as Pam noted, certainly want to make sure that everyone has an opportunity to comment on these projects. Next slide, please, David. And this one, Barb had mentioned the Shared Streets program, so I won't go over the details, but again, here are some of the specifics of the program. I will add that commission staff are certainly available to assist the towns or any agencies on the Cape that are interested in these grant applications, or actually already actively working with a couple municipalities that are interested in this round and have talked to others that were successful in prior rounds and really thought it was a great opportunity, a relatively low lift in terms of a grant application. So certainly happy to support any municipalities looking to submit one of these grant applications. Next slide. Just a couple other notes. Another great grant opportunity we had mentioned is that the last couple of meetings, we're getting real close to the deadline now. February 1st is the grant, this latest grant round for Mass Trails. We've had a couple of successful grants in this region over the last couple of rounds, so appreciate that. A couple other active projects going on right now. And we're working on a Falmouth Complete Streets prioritization plan. So there's currently a survey open where we're doing a review of the prioritized projects. So comments on that will be open through February 16th. We'll be closing out both Bourne and Falmouth Complete Streets prioritization plan in the next couple months. Looking forward to some potential grant applications there. Also want to share a project we're not working on, but certainly want to highlight it, is with the town of Sandwich, and their bike committee is working on a bike planning project to connect from the service road up to the canal path, funded by Mass Trails. The survey there is open until today. So if you're interested, get on there real quick and send them some information. And finally, just wanted to highlight something we've been doing as staff that I think is important. Everyone who's on this call has a good idea of what the Tipping UPWP is, or bringing a version of this presentation to bike advocates across the region. So Colleen's been organizing this group the last month and a half, and it became clear that this was something they were interested in learning a little about more, how to channel their enthusiasm for those improvements into a program that is funded, that has opportunity to make some of the changes they're looking to see. So we'll be hosting a virtual meetup later this week, and hope to do some in-person events as the season warms and hopefully everything else trends in the right direction. And I think that's my last slide, Mr. Chair. So certainly open to any questions.
All right, any questions from Mr. Tupper? Kevin?
You're muted.
Go back, if I could, Mr. Chair, to Chris Kennedy or Leah from CCRTA.
Sure.
In the best of all worlds, when might we see those EVs on your DART program showing up on the streets?
Sure, I'll be happy to answer that. they will be purchased. We are hoping to purchase within fiscal year 22.
Thank you.
All right, anyone else? Any questions for Steve? Judith, go ahead.
I'm sorry, not sure I can manipulate this. In terms of the design public hearings, I want to commend you for making the information available. And I've noticed more emails about it, and I think that that's really helpful for getting the word out. I have a question about that, the process in terms of the design plans, you get the public comment and all of that. Is there something more we can do in terms of helping people understand how long it takes to get to the actual design and where they can get that information? It's funny because I've had a number of people comment about, well, now what? So that would be helpful. Thank you.
So Judith, on that, I know that not only the districts, but headquarters and highway has done a lot of work on that. So why don't I talk to them and see what the best way to address that is? Does that make sense?
Yeah, that'd be great. Yeah, because people are enthusiastic, and then they're like, well, what now?
Yeah, yeah. And now that there's going to be additional funding and all that stuff, there's even more of those questions. So I get it.
Right.
So, yeah. All right.
Thank you.
No problem. Any other questions people had under reports?
I have one question.
All right, go ahead, Judith.
I'd like to know if we are really indeed going to have status reports from MassDOT about the bridges, about, what, even if the next phase is something fairly, not reportable, but at least that it shows some progress, and it shows that, I don't know, I think that keeping that connection, that the dotted line, so between the early conversations about the bridges to the design phases and the research and the background that's going on right now, at least if people know, okay, so we're getting an update there, this is what is going on right now, even if it seems repetitive to MassDOT, I think it's really helpful to our communities to know, okay, it didn't just start and stop. Thanks.
So Judith, I am not involved at all in the bridges project. So I will bring that back to folks and see how we can potentially do something like that. So I'll bring that back as well.
Yeah. So, I mean, even if it's just a, 5 minute update, or not even a 5 minute update, but, some type of update so that there's acknowledgement in our public record that what the progress is and, what phase are we on, so that people know that it is still being talked about and they're not getting to a point where all of a sudden, the decisions are all made, you hear that.
Yep,
I hear that from people. So thank you.
Yep. All right. Anything else? All right. I think we're on to agenda item 11, new business. I know I don't have any. Steve, is there any other business you know of? Anyone else have any new business?
Not from commission staff. I don't see any other hands at this point.
All right. Why don't we move to agenda item 12, adjournment. Can I get a motion a second to adjourn, please?
Harold Mitchell, make a motion to adjourn.
Kevin Galligan, second.
All right. Steve, you want to read the roll, please?
Certainly. Steve Wolfel?
Yes.
Pam Hasner?
Yes.
Harold Mitchell?
Yes.
Robert Lawton?
Yes.
And Mark Forrest had to step away. Rob Steen?
Yes.
Judith Froman?
Yes.
Cheryl McMahon?
Yes.
Kevin Galligan?
Yes.
We have a yes vote, Mr. Chair.
All right. Thank you, everyone. Really productive meeting, good presentations. As we enter a busy season, which is only going to be busier than ever, probably. So everyone, stay safe, and we'll see you next month.